Live from the Washington, D.C. area, it's the Emerald Planet. All the ecology news that our viewers want to know. Now, here's your host, Executive Director of the Emerald Planet, Dr. Sam Lee Hancock.
Hello, and welcome to the Emerald Planet as we come to you from Washington, D.C. on a week-to-week basis as we look around the globe in 144 different nations, looking for those best practices, technology, services, products, and the people, of course, that are making a difference as we move through the 21st century. And as we go to a planet that will have about 9 billion people by 2050, how are we going to provide all the basic infrastructure as education, healthcare, food, and also the food, the fuel, the fiber, everything that we need for an increased quality of life and not just to exist. And we have two gentlemen. One is sitting in the studio with me, and the other is going to be coming in by telephone. Mark E. Snyder, the president of Mark Snyder Electric. He's also a sustainability advocate, renewable energy expert. And something that's coming very important is a fire forensic expert witness, because he lives in the state of California. And so he'll be talking about some of that. He is coming in by telephone, and then by in-studio special guest is Alexander. It goes by Lex Henkels. He's the president of Providence Trade and Development. And Lex, thank you for being here.
Thank you for the invitation.
Glad to have you here. And Mark, I think you're with us, all right, correct?
Yes, I am, Sam. Hey. Thank you. I'm happy to be here, too.
Well, we're always glad to have you. You've been on with us before, and every time you come on is always a new and dynamic and interesting topic. But tell us a little bit about your organization as a background, because even though it's called Mike Snyder Electric, actually it's really about innovation as far as renewable energy is concerned. And really it's almost like a social enterprise that's helping communities, particularly Native American nations throughout the United States. Tell us a little bit about that, and then let's get into this CCA. We'll describe that in a minute, and how that relates to renewable energy.
Okay. Is my company, Mark Snyder Electric, I've been in business for 39 years. I'm an electrical contractor, a renewable energy and electrical forensics company. I made the decision because of my attitudes towards, the world and making changes and wanting to move towards renewables. I integrated renewable energy, energy efficiency, and even some waste to energy into my business 39 years ago. My company has installed over 20,000 off-grid and on-grid systems nationwide, and I've done some very prominent Native American projects. The one that's being displayed is the Plateau Solar Project, which I did on Navajo Nation with Elsa Johnson, Department of Energy, Arizona State University, and the USDA. These are very important projects. One of the other large global projects I did in 2010 was with the, I was requested to come up with a solution to help prevent a cholera epidemic in Iraq, and I invented a mobile solar-powered water purification system that I constructed and helped deploy, and it's in 325 villages in Iraq, and it serves 600,000 Iraqi citizens, providing clean water every day.
And yeah, that's absolutely fantastic, Mark. Let's go into this community choice aggregation, this CCA. Yeah. Something's been around a long time, but as you know, what is old is new again, what is new is old. And tell us a little bit about that. And I have this chart up here, and I know that you probably can't see it, but this is called a Community Choice Aggregation, CCA. Tell us a little bit about that, and we have this as a backdrop so that people can actually see what it really is all about.
Yeah, I'm actually seeing it live streaming on YouTube. So CCAs are a local, not-for-profit public agency that takes on the decision-making role about the sources of energy for electricity generation. Once the CCA is established, they become the default service provider for the power mix being delivered to the customer. And as you see in the center of the chart, the actual incumbent utility, whoever's serving the area, continues to maintain the power lines and transmission lines in the cities or in the states, and they take care of the metering and billing. And in some cities, the CCA has become like a de facto public utility.
I tell you, it's really very interesting what we have here, looking at source, delivery, and the customer. Why is this so special and what you're doing here and the uniqueness of the source of the energy and the special use that actually the utility is being made of to serve the customer?
Well, what's really unique about community choice aggregation is that it's local, and it's what we call distributed energy, where the local in the West, they're moving towards renewables. In the eastern U.S., what they're doing is they're consolidating and making power purchase agreements, purchasing the most cost-effective energy. The big change in the East has been the reduction of energy costs for the consumer. Literally billions of dollars have been saved in the states that have community choice. And in the West, community choice has been used as an instrument to leapfrog and really advance renewable energy, both wind and solar and other forms of renewable energy.
Yeah, I know this is something that actually in some of the cities are using the, like, low-flow hydro, using the water distribution system to actually generate electricity. And, of course, then you have thermal energy and a lot of others, too, Mark. And thank you for sharing that with us. And we have your good friend and colleague, Lex, sitting right beside me, as you heard before. And he actually has the next question. Lex?
Hello, Mark. How, when, and why did the community choice aggregation, or CCA, movement start?
Well, it's very interesting. I actually had a program. I co-hosted and produced a radio program on a 50,000-watt clear channel station in San Diego from 97 to 2003. And we actually had the father of community choice on. We tried to get him for the program, but he had conflicts of scheduling. His name is Paul Finn. Paul was a political science major with a master's degree from the University of Illinois. And Paul got a job in the Senate of the state of Massachusetts, and he was on the Senate Senate Energy Committee, and he was asked to come up with a bill. And Paul actually said to me on the program, said, "Mark, I never dreamed my bill would be accepted." So what he did is he came up with kind of a dream bill, which embodies community choice. And he said that he actually got the idea for this bill from deregulation in Britain, and Margaret Thatcher had actually originally come up with this. Pretty amazing. But Paul went on to get his bill unanimously accepted in the Massachusetts Senate and the legislature, and Massachusetts became the first community choice state in the country. It was Senate Bill 447, if anybody wants to look it up. But from 1995 to 2000, Paul broke open the Western market for five other states, and in the Eastern market for five other states. That was Ohio, New Jersey, Rhode Island, and Illinois. All of them put in community choice laws.
Looking at that, and piggybacking on this question that Lex just shared with you, and I think you've given us the number of states, but also maybe the cities. And what's special about these states that they were willing to actually to embrace this movement and really take it forward at a very rapid rate, and yet there's many other states that are still either looking at it or really don't know much about it?
That's an excellent question, Sam. What happened was those states... Their populations were burdened by doubling and tripling of their electric bills. And so, like Massachusetts, they decided to break up the utility monopoly of supplying power and they found through community choice that they could supply power at half or much less than they were currently paying. So it was a monetary, it was mostly a monetary incentive. This was before a lot of renewables came in the eastern U.S.
Yeah, that's absolutely fantastic. How many cities actually have CCA, and then how successful have these programs been, maybe vis-a-vis the states, or do they actually complement what the state's been able to realize as far as benefits and expansion in, back into distributed energy systems?
That's an excellent question also, Sam. Is what's happened is that the eastern states greatly lowered their energy costs, and those states have realized literally billions of dollars of energy cost savings to their citizens. And what happened was in the West, it became a great means to push forward renewable energy and to be able to bring what happened was actually Paul Finn was also responsible for bringing in something called H-bonds that financed solar energy and distributed generation, and the first of the community choice cities or areas, actually a county, was Marin County, and we've got the pleasure of Jamie from Marin Community or County Electric is going to be on later to tell a lot more of the ins and outs and the daily problems that they've and issues they've have had to overcome.
Fantastic. Mark, we're just about running out of time. Lex has another question, but we have to be quick on that, and I have one to close out. So, Lex?
Mark, what other services are being offered by CCA, and why are these additional services crucial to the overall success of CCA?
Well, CCA has brought a lot of competition now in the market, where actually Con Edison has become more competitive in the East. So for CCAs to keep their cutting edge, they've gotten into energy efficiency and into other services that help bring down electric bills.
Well, that's fantastic. What do you see for the expansion of CCA over the next 5, 10, 15 years, Mark? Short answer.
That it's going to expand like a rocket ship. It's going to be the major force that changes regulation in our country.
That's fantastic. This is Mark E. Snyder, President of Mark Snyder Electric, doing multiple other things. And Lex is sitting right beside me. And
you know what, guys? There's a lot of tree branches and dry brush over here. We should probably move the bonfire over there.
I'm guessing Smokey liked that idea.
Hey, Hard, what's this?
That's my resignation. You're resigning.
Why? You've been putting me under a lot of pressure lately. That's why I'm ready to quit.
Oh, I forgot. I'll do better. Please don't quit on me.
Don't let your heart quit on you. Get your uncontrolled high blood pressure to a healthy range before it's too late.
So you can't save money? That's easy as pie. Brown bag and lunch instead of going out. $6 save times 5 days a week times 10 years is $21,000. That's a lot of lettuce. Small changes today, big bucks tomorrow. Feedthepig.org.
Did you know kids who play outdoors have healthier lungs?
Totally.
I did. Did you know that boys that play with dolls make better husbands?
My son has lots of dolls.
But did you know terrycloth diapers breathe better?
I did.
Mm-hmm. Totally true.
Oh, yeah, yeah.
Did you know that strollers have the right of way on the sidewalk?
Yes.
Yep, I did. Did you guys
did
know?
Did you know that kids who eat breakfast have higher GPAs?
Yeah, I know.
Okay. Yeah. That's actually what I was going to say.
Did you know babies should never touch silver? It's really bad for them.
I knew that.
Did you guys know that statistically friendly kids have more friends?
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
That's obvious.
Did you know most people think they're using the right car seat for their kid, but they're not?
Parents who really know it all know for sure that their child is in the right seat at the right age and size. Visit safercar.gov/the right seat to make sure your child is protected.
I'm putting that on my blog.
I just put it in mine.
we're back to the Inside Scoop Emerald Planet. Here again, your host, Dr. Sam.
Well, welcome to the Emerald Planet as we come to you on a week-to-week basis looking for those 1,000 best practices and the ways that we're going to move forward in the 21st century. As we go to a planet of 9 billion people by 2050 and possibly 12 to 13 billion by the end of this century, how are we going to be able to take care of all these people so that we're increasing the quality of life and not just existing? And we have someone that's coming on that's going to be talking with us about a very special program called Community Choice Aggregation, CCA. And this is Jamie Tuckey. She is the Director of Public Affairs for MCE, Community Choice Aggregation. She's coming in by Skype. And our good friend is sitting right beside me, our special guest, Alexander. He goes by Lex Henkels, and he's the President of Providence Trade and Development in Providence Trade. Jamie, I think you're already here by Skype, correct?
Hi.
Hey, yes, welcome back. Glad to have you with us. And I was telling Lex that you and I chatted more than just the length of the television program. There's so much that you're doing out there in California. It's really exciting. So welcome to Emerald Planet.
Thank you.
Tell us a little bit about MCE and what you're doing as far as the community choice aggregation. And then let's talk about how all this fits into, you know, the broad scheme of energy distributed renewables on a local community by community basis in California.
Great. Well, MCE is quite proudly California's first operating community choice aggregation program. We formed in 2008 and we launched service in 2010 to customers in the San Francisco Bay Area. And our purpose, our whole reason for existence, is to address climate change by reducing energy-related greenhouse gas emissions. And we do that by procuring renewable energy supply and providing it to our customers at affordable rates, while also making sure that we are creating local workforce and economic benefits.
I tell you, it's really impressive just how broad the services are that you've created out there. And I was looking at some of the photographs that you shared, and the inclusiveness and the diversity of people that you're actually bringing in and training and really helping them to work in their own communities is quite impressive. And I think that's one of the, you know, the hidden strengths of what it is that you're doing. What's the origins of CCA in California, and why California of all places?
That's a great question. So community choice aggregation was created in California really in response to the energy crisis that we had in the late 1990s and ended up bankrupting the three investor-owned utilities here. The legislation was passed, Assembly Bill 117, in 2002 by our legislators to really open up the energy market and allow for some competition where there was none before. It was unique in California, I think, compared to some of the other states, because here we have a real focus on cleaner energy. Yes, we want to provide lower and affordable and stable rates, but we're really looking to lead the way for building new cleaner energy supplies and switching away from fossil fuels.
Looking at this chart, I think you can see this, how CCA works. Go through this diagram, and then Lex has the next question for you. But let's talk about this diagram first. I think this really fits into where we are right now.
Yeah, so this is a great explanation of how CCA programs work. So basically, local governments are allowed in California to create their own organizations that are responsible for the generation of power. So when you're thinking about your electricity, you're turning your lights on, there's really two main services, and that's the generation and determining where it comes from. In this case, the local government determines the source, and like I said, we are definitely going for more renewable energy. And the investor-owned utility continues to provide the delivery services. So that's the other major part of your electric service. So maintaining the lines and wires, if the power ever goes out, the investor-owned utility still does that, getting the electricity from point A to point B. And for the customer, they now have a choice in where their energy comes from.
Yeah, and I think that's just incredible, where you can actually, it's almost like check the box and determine where you're going to get your energy. And many people would like to have it local, because that's local jobs, local tax base, and also friends and neighbors, maybe even family members that are actually working to produce this power. I think what a great win-win, Lex.
Absolutely.
Absolutely a win-win. And why don't you go ahead and ask the next question, please?
Yes, Jamie, how does MCE secure renewable energy sources, and why is this effort so important, not only to the environment, but to the ratepayers as well?
Well, we procure, we contract for our electricity through a variety of suppliers throughout California. We have short and long-term contracts, and what's happening is that all kinds of new energy is being built for our customers. So we've got over 24 megawatts of new California renewable electricity being built for our customers. I'm sorry, I said 24 megawatts. I meant 813, which is quite a bit more. So we've got 813 megawatts of new California energy being put online for our customers. In 2016, we think we were actually the biggest contractor for renewable energy. And because we're able to enter into long-term contracts, we can lock in the rates. And that means that our customers are paying stable and affordable rates over time. We don't have any shareholder profits or dividends that we have to pay out, and so it enables us to keep our rates super affordable and be more efficient for our customers.
Yeah, and then looking at the workers that we have in this image right here, I'm going to let you talk about that in a minute, but name some of the communities that you're involved with through MCE. Why did you select these particular communities? And how are they directly benefiting from everything that's going on through the CCA itself?
We serve 33 communities in the San Francisco Bay Area. And when we started service, it was in 2010 to Marin County only. Marin County was pursuing CCA as a really great opportunity to help them achieve their climate action plan, their climate action plan goals in reducing greenhouse gas emissions. So we launched service in Marin County, but today we also serve all of Napa County, the city of Benicia and Solano County, and 14 of the 20 communities in Contra Costa County. I think these, you know, actually, so when we started with Marin County, we didn't realize that we were going to be growing because it hasn't been done in California, and we faced a bit of a battle to launch our organization. But within a year or so, we were starting to get requests from neighboring communities and counties who were seeing the differences that we were making in the community, the happy customers, the impacts to their climate action plans, and we were getting requests to join us. So it was actually these other communities who reached out to us. They were wanting local control, competition in business, and the opportunity to give their residents and businesses the power to choose where their energy was coming from.
That's absolutely incredible. Give us at least three examples that demonstrate the positive community impact that you're showing through MCE, but also through the community choice aggregation process itself.
I think first and foremost is the build out of renewables in California, but not just in California. You know, you actually have a chance to build local renewables in your community. We've got 20 megawatts within the communities that we serve. It's enough to provide service for 10,000 homes a year. And some really amazing things come along with that, besides being, you know, more sustainable communities. You are creating economic impacts, great economic impacts when you're working with local businesses who are building these small-scale projects for us. And then the jobs that come with it, So job training, we partner a lot with organizations in the communities to make sure that we're giving people the opportunity to build their skills and join the green workforce. We just completed a 10.5 megawatt project in the city of Richmond, and it was a partnership with the city, and we promised that at least half of the 340 jobs that were required to build it would be local. And so we had Richmond residents in there actually building that project for us. Yeah. We also Okay. Other projects that we have are things like electric vehicles, you know, funding the installation of charging stations and public parking lots so that we can help with that transition to electrification, and energy efficiency projects for residents, businesses, and multifamily units.
I'm going to just jump in here, Lex, if you don't mind, and I'll let you ask your question. But looking at this image just came up here, Suzanne from Manassas was intrigued by your statement of, you know, providing local employment, training, so it's like technical transfer of skills and all that. In this photograph here, tell us what we're looking at and how this actually has a real impact within a place like Richmond or any of the communities that you're serving. If we can bring that image back up, that would be fantastic. There we go. Tell us a little bit about these people and why it's so important to be hiring local and creating the job skill sets right there.
Mm-hmm. This is a photo of a project that was in construction in Novato, a Cooley Quarry, and it's a 1 megawatt solar project. What's actually really unique about this project is that it's it was a 1 megawatt solar project built on a brownfield site. A brownfield is basically an area of land that was used for something in the past that makes it so that you can't use it for anything else. You can't build on it. It's not something that you can use for like hiking or public parks because it was a rock quarry where they mined for serpentine. So we had a great opportunity to turn this unusable land into a place where we could build solar, which of course is great for our environment. And the photo that you see here are some of the workers who are building it and a couple of our elected officials from Marin County and the city of Novato. And this particular project is special because it ties into one of the three service options that we offer to our customers. One of them is 100% renewable, and anyone in our service area can choose to buy 100% solar that comes from this project here in Novato.
We're absolutely out of time, so you have to be quick. What do you see for the expansion of MCE and CAA in your area, say, over the next 5, 10, to 15 years? You got about 20 seconds to do all that.
All right. Well, I think we've seen incredible growth since 2014. We've got about 12 different operating CCA programs in California, and I think we're going to unite and grow together in order to achieve the environmental impacts and help our planet.
Jamie, we're going to lose you. Jamie Tuckey, okay. And thank you, and Lex, as we create the Emerald Planet.
You know what, guys? There's a lot of tree branches and dry brush over here. We should probably move the bonfire over there.
I'm guessing Smokey liked that idea.
Hey, Hard, what's this?
That's my resignation. You're resigning.
Why?
You've been putting me under a lot of pressure lately. That's why I'm ready to quit.
Oh, I forgot. I'll do better. Please don't quit on me.
Don't let your heart quit on you. Get your uncontrolled high blood pressure to a healthy range before it's too late.
So you can't save money? That's easy as pie. Brown bagging lunch instead of going out. $6 save times 5 days a week times 10 years is $21,000. That's a lot of lettuce. Small changes today, big bucks tomorrow. Feedthepig.org.
Did you know kids who play outdoors have healthier lungs?
Totally.
I did. Did you know that boys that play with dolls make better husbands?
My son has lots of dolls. But did you know terrycloth diapers breathe better?
I did.
Mm-hmm. It's totally true.
Oh, yeah, yeah.
Did you know that strollers have the right of way on the sidewalk?
Yes.
Yep, I did. Did you guys
did
know?
Did you know that kids who eat breakfast have higher GPAs?
Yeah, I know.
Yeah. That's actually what I was going to say.
Did you know babies should never touch silver? It's really bad for them.
I knew that.
Did you guys know that statistically friendly kids have more friends?
Mm-hmm. Yeah. That's obvious.
Did you know most people think they're using the right car seat for their kid, but they're not?
Parents who really know it all know for sure that their child is in the right seat at the right age and size. Visit safercar.gov/the right seat to make sure your child is protected.
I'm putting that on my blog.
I just put it in mine.
We're back to the Inside Scoop Emerald Planet. Here again, your host, Dr. Sam.
Hello, welcome. As we look around the globe looking for the what we call the best of the best practices that actually provide real solutions to real problems as we move through the 21st century. And as climate change is alive and well and wreaking havoc on the weather and the real climate on a day-to-day basis, all of us need to take everything that's going on very seriously. But how are we going to be able to address this so that we provide the solutions and help people to move forward in very positive ways as we go towards 2050 and not just stand in fright and fret about, you know, what we can't do, but focus on what can be done. And a gentleman that's going to come on is going to talk about those very issues. And then I have one sitting right beside me in the studio, but Bentham, he goes by Ben Charles Paulos. He's a principal of Paulos Analysis. He's an energy policy advocacy. He works in communications and also a renewable energy expert. He's coming in by Skype. And then our good friend Alexander, he goes by Lex Henkels, is sitting right beside me. He's the president of Providence Trade and Development and Providence Trade. And Ben, I think you're already here by Skype, correct?
Yes, I'm here.
Hey, glad to have you. Welcome.
And thanks, Matt.
Tell us a little bit about your organization and the very special services that you provide in this whole realm as a CCA choice, community choice aggregation.
Well, I'm a consultant and a writer. I've written about community choice aggregation for Power Magazine and the Energy Transition blog. I also do consulting, although I've never consulted with any of the CCAs.
Now, looking at what you're doing, from your perspective, what is community choice aggregation, CCA? It seems to be a very hot topic these days. And what type of communities are accepting the promise as far as resiliency, sustainability, but also affordability of renewable energy as we move forward towards 2050?
Community choice aggregation is, you can consider it the Costco of energy. It's essentially a buying club where a city or county, a local government, can procure electricity on behalf of all of its citizens and businesses. It's been authorized in, I think, 6 states, but it's really only taken off in 2 states so far, California and Illinois. It's in some cases, it is definitely a driver for sustainability and environmental improvement. In other cases, really, it's the motivation is to simply save money.
Well, saving money to start with, that's a very good reason to do it. But at the same time, if you can protect the environment but increase the economy, those are two powerful drivers, as you know, Ben. And thank you for sharing that with us. Why don't you ask your question?
Yes.
Take off, Lex.
Bentham, why are communities interested in using community choice aggregation, and is it a hard sell for those communities? If so, why? If not, why not?
Yeah. Well, the states with the most activity, Illinois and California, I wrote about them in Power Magazine last May. Really, the motivation in Illinois was to save money. There were over 600 communities, something like 80% of residential electricity consumption switched over to community choice aggregation. There was this very brief window where they were able to save quite a bit of money. So that was the motivation there. There was very little interest in environmental improvement among those communities. In California, really, it's the opposite. The state of California has very aggressive renewable energy and climate goals, but there are a number of communities who felt like they were not aggressive enough and that we could do better. And I live in California, so I guess I should say we, that they could do better. So the real motivation for Marin Clean Energy, Sonoma, and San Francisco and others was really to move more quickly on climate change than the state was. It helped that the declining cost of renewable energy made it so that they could be more aggressive on renewables for the same price, essentially. So it's been a real compelling value proposition in California that you can be more green environmentally and save some green financially.
That's fantastic. I've left this map up purposely, and our viewers probably saying, why do we keep looking at this map? But I think it's important. Looking at these other states, you know, talk about California, Illinois, but you have Ohio, New York, both of which are considered to be states that are very concerned about the environment, but also the economy. And then you have, looks like Minnesota here, Nevada. Tell us about these other areas and why are they part of the mix? And where do you see them in the continuum, you know, from what's happening in Illinois to California?
Mm-hmm. So Massachusetts is really had the very first community choice aggregation in the country in the Cape Light Compact on Cape Cod. Back in 1997, I think they started. But it's been very slow to expand other communities. It's really just now spreading. Just in the last month or so, I think Boston has decided to do a CCA. And in Massachusetts, again, the driver has been largely to try to save some money. The communities that have more aggressive renewable energy features are very, very mild, you know, just a few percent more than what's required by state law. In New York, there's been a pilot program in Westchester County, just north of New York City. And there are a number of other communities that are preparing for CCA. But they're apparently waiting for state regulators to finalize the rules to enable them to do it beyond the pilot program. In Ohio, New Jersey, Rhode Island, there's essentially no activity.
No, it's just pending there. Looking at, we'll just go through this, but look, going back to Illinois and California, what are some of the best practices we learned from each state? You said in Illinois is about the money. In California, they wanted to be very aggressive on the side of using renewables, but at the same time to be able to cut the overhead and the costs and all this. What would be some of the best practices, Ben, that have come out of these two states that the late adopters are going to be able to benefit from?
Mm-hmm. Well, you know, one thing that is really still emerging in California is that the CCAs put a very high value on local activity. They really want local jobs, local energy production. Another revolution that's happening in the electric industry right now is distributed energy, not just rooftop solar, which is very common in California and increasingly common across the country, but also distributed energy storage, controls for energy systems in buildings and on homes, and something called demand response, which allows utilities to reduce power demand in order to save money on the grid or increase reliability on the grid. So those are all distributed technologies that can be put in homes and businesses, you know, throughout the neighborhood, throughout a service territory. And the CCAs, because they put such a large premium on local action, I think will be very aggressive in the area of distributed energy, more so than the utilities have been. So I think that that's really still emerging. They're still really working out how to do that. But I think that will be a real hallmark of community choice aggregators in California.
Lex, why don't you ask your next question, please, sir?
Ben, what challenges do California communities that have adopted CCA face, and what lessons might be learned and shared with other communities considering CCA?
Mm-hmm. Well, the biggest challenges in California right now have to do with some regulatory issues. When customers depart from an investor-owned utility, they're leaving behind all of the contracts that utility signed on their behalf. The three investor-owned utilities in California have signed long-term contracts to serve their customers. And as those customers leave, they want those customers to pay an exit fee to cover the past cost of those contracts. That exit fee has the potential to be financially, to cripple CCAs in California, it can undermine that value proposition that I mentioned earlier, where you can be renewable and save money. If it increases their rates quite a bit, then the customers, then the communities will be less likely to create CCAs or to continue them. That is exactly what happened in Illinois. As actually you can see in the map on the screen, or that graph on the screen. In Illinois, there was a brief window where CCAs could save their customers a lot of money, which is why you saw such a stampede of, you know, 600 communities doing it. But as that window closed due to regulatory reasons, the default supply from the regulated investor-owned utilities became competitive with the CCA rate. So, in other words, the communities were no longer able to save money. So many of them have given up on CCA, have sent their customers back to the investor-owned utilities. So really the big risk in any of these states is that that relationship between the CCA and the regulated market, the regulated utility. In most cases, CCAs are a form of energy competition, and energy competition for residential customers has been very, very poor in the United States. It's really been largely a failed experiment. It's been very common and very popular for larger customers, commercial and industrial customers. But for small customers, there's been very little energy, very little choice, very little money saved. It's a really very small market and has really not played out as people thought it would.
Yeah, looking at this, and we've just absolutely run out of time. I'm not even sure I can ask this question, but looking at this, Ben, what do you see for the growth and development of CCAs, you know, in Illinois, California, and other states? Looking at this chart of the balance between the CCA, the utility, and the customer, and we got about 20 seconds to do all that.
Yeah,
gotta be quick.
Well, I think. I would like to see CCAs in Illinois realize that they can do more than just sell electricity, that they can provide services, energy efficiency, community solar services, really be a community entity rather than just a power supplier.
Fantastic. This is Ben Charles Palos of Palos Analysis. Right beside me is Lex Henkels of his own Providence Trade and Development. Thank you for being with us as we talk about CCAs as we look around the globe to create the Emerald Planet.
What would you bring to my company?
What do you need?
I need problem-solving skills.
I got through high school without a car, a phone, or a computer.
No college degree, though.
Not yet, but life's taught me a lot, and I'm ready for more.
Well, you're not the typical kind of candidate that I hire. But you are exactly what I'm looking for.
Your company could be missing out on the candidates it needs most. Learn how to find a great pool of untapped talent at gradsoflife.org.
They'll test you. Try to break your will. But however loud the loudness gets, however many cheese puffs may fly, you're the driver, the one in control. Stand firm. Just wait. And move only when you hear the click that says they're buckled in for the drive. Never give up till they buckle up.
We're back to the Inside Scoop Emerald Planet. Here again, your host, Dr. Sam.
Hello, and welcome to the Emerald Planet. We come to you on a week-to-week basis looking around the globe for what we call the best of the best practices that are true solutions to bring about reliability, sustainability, quality, and all the other terms that we apply to how we're going to go from here to 2050 and absorb 2 billion new people on planet Earth, not only to bring them in to the cultures and the countries where they're going to exist, but also to feel and figure out how we're going to give them increased quality of life and not just exist. And we have two gentlemen, one of which who's coming in with us by telephone, the other is sitting right in the studio with me. Marky Snyder, president of Mark Snyder Electric LLC. He's a sustainability advocate, renewable energy expert, inventor, master electrician, and a fire forensics expert witness, which we're going to talk about in a minute. He's coming in by telephone. And then Lex Henkels is sitting right beside me. He's the president of Providence Trade and Development and has been working with Emerald Planet in the past as far as providing us really good, smart people, as we're doing this time. But Mark, you're here by telephone, I think, and welcome back to the Emerald Planet TV.
Hi, Sam.
Glad to have you. We got your handsome, smiling face here with all these solar panels in behind you. Tell us a little bit about some of these titles that I rattled off here: sustainability, renewable energy expert, and fire forensic expert witness. Tell us why this combination of skill sets is so important in today's world and how it impacts on how people are thinking about living and adapting to the new climate conditions that you're faced with in California, but literally all around the globe.
Well, all around the globe and here in California, we have similar issues. Is electricity is kind of a mature business and engineering model. You know, it's been around for some almost 125 years now, since the early 1900s it developed and got perfected. Solar has only been really around grid tie since the late 90s and early 2000. So what we found, we as part of our business model, we do electrical work in incidents of fire, flood, and explosion. And what we've actually been experiencing is a lot of inexperience to convert an electrical contractor into a solar contractor, or convert a lot of states, they allowed the plumbing contractors, the ones that did solar thermal or even roofers, to do solar installation. So we've actually seen a lot of defective systems. We've actually, my company is, we've personally responded to over 50 solar fires caused by improper installations and hundreds, literally hundreds of roof leak situations that end up causing short circuits or problems in homes, businesses, and industrial schools and industrial properties. So part of my business has been dedicated over the last, since the inception of solar. We were early adopters starting in the late 1970s. So we became really good at it and experts. So by the time it went into grid tie, we started seeing a lot of bad systems. So we end up having to do a lot of forensic work on repairing systems.
Okay, I'm going to jump over a question, bring that back up later. But Lex, why don't you start off, because we're talking about worldwide pollution, solid waste, and really repositioning or reusing some of this waste. So let's go into that, and then we'll come back to this other topic.
Mark, one of the slides that was on while you were speaking was plastic in the ocean. How can community choice aggregation help solve the tremendous problem that the world has with solid waste, plastic in the ocean, hazardous waste, municipal solid waste, et cetera?
Well, this is a very good question. Cities and municipalities are already set up with a waste disposal system. Right now, what they're doing is they're putting it into landfills. Only about 3 to 4% of plastic globally is actually being recycled. We're in the U.S., we're better than most, but this is a terrible figure. 97% of it goes into 96-97% goes into landfills. It sits on our beaches, washes out into the ocean, and we've created these horrible gyres, and also we're polluting the soil and our environment with plastics. So there is a clean, green technology that you and I both visited a plant in Germany, in Forst, right near Berlin, that has invented a completely clean technology that takes plastics, solid waste, municipal solid waste, and it converts it. It takes the latent energy out of it and can convert it into a thermal gas, and that gas can run a turbine and generate electricity. So we see this as one of the great futures. We're at about 13% nationally as far as renewables now, and with CCAs in California, we expect that to increase. But as Ben said, there are obstructions to that with the IOU, with the investor-owned utilities. So we really think that the waste energy is going to be, especially thermolysis, which is a clean, green method that will reduce waste going into landfills by in the vicinity of 96 to 97%, that's a very, very important subject that all of us have to meet, and CCAs are well equipped to do this.
Mark, I'm putting up three of the photographs here. I think you can see these, but you see this plastic floating. Then we have all these goats that I was talking with you about last night when we're selecting the slides we're going to be using today, and then this solid waste and various countries all around the globe. A lot of this is just out in the open communities. But how can we take all of this waste, what we saw earlier, the plastics floating in the ocean, then animals literally feeding off of this waste, and then waste, such large horrific amounts of this is being generated, all across, as the example, the African continent and Latin America, Southeast Asia, the South Pacific. How can we then tie this into the CCA, this community choice aggregation movement, but to make the power grid much more stable and reliable, and at the same time lower cost, but get rid of all this, what we now calling waste, and calling it, in a sense, it's almost like a renewable energy source with the plastics and the solid waste. How does all this fit together? And many people are saying they really don't, but I think you see that there's a path forward to do all of this in one fell swoop.
I do. If we're going to fill up the balance of 87% of the rest of the energy that's needed in order to get off the L standard, what we need to do is we need to be looking at the latent energy that we're just throwing away and creating more pollutions and problems later that have to be dealt with. Building a containment field to put trash into is very, very expensive. Building a thermolysis plant is the relative expense compared to landfills. This is a solution that we need to be looking at for community choice cities and for all of the world, really. These are latent energy sources that could be used in Africa. These huge mountains of trash that we found in Nigeria, where we went to do a feasibility study on a waste energy plant. This is huge, vast amounts of energy that is latent that could be put on the grid and supplied to the public.
Yeah, and I'm going back through these images that we have here, Mark, this giant pile of waste. And actually, these are small compared to some of these things that they take. You know, it could be 100 acres of land that's just laid barren because of all this hard waste. And here is just a mountain of plastic bottles, sitting in a warehouse somewhere, and a gentleman trying to sweep up and take care of this. But going to this plant that we're looking at right here, how is this the secret sauce as far as turning all that municipal solid waste, industrial solid waste, and the plastics into something that is needed everywhere on the planet, which is low cost, readily available, sustainable energy.
Yeah, well, that's an excellent question, Sam. What this German technology that's patent, EPA approved, and is an excellent technology is a non-incineration method. And what they do is in an oxygen-free environment, they drive out the volatile gases, much of which the gases are hydrogen, butane, propane, all the flammables. And that gas, they clean it up, they recycle, they run it through this cycle many times. So what it does is it takes the dioxins and all the poisons that are spewed into the atmosphere from burning trash, it takes and confines those, actually turns them into more energy, and the outgoing coming out of the plant, depending on what the feedstock is, comes a mineral salt or a non-toxic something that can be landfilled, put into concrete or something or other things. So this is a very viable method that has come into its own now and is actually practical to deploy.
Yeah, and this is also something we're showing here, these trailers. So this could actually be put anywhere. Lex, we're running out of time. Why don't you ask your question? Mark, we need to be quick on the answer, and then have one last question as we part company for this particular show.
Mark, you are a fire forensics expert witness, and considering the drastic climate change that's taking place around the world and in California, how does your skill set fit into community choice aggregation and its long-term goals?
Well, that's a good question. My skill set is driven by my mission to preserve the environment and our habitat and to bring renewable energy. So I'm known as a doer, and I see these things that need to get done and see ways to get them done.
Thank you, Mark. This is Mark Snyder, and sitting right beside me is Lex Henkels. And we're talking about all the new ways to address solid waste, the municipal, industrial, residential, and how to turn that into renewable energy. Lex, thank you for being with us. Thank you, Mark. Thank you, dear viewers, as we create the Emerald Planet.